Hey guys, it's Key here from KegLand. I just want to talk to you today about our stainless steel KegMenters. Now we call them KegMenters because essentially it's a fermenter made out of a keg, but it's also a multi-purpose device, a little bit more like a uni-tank, I guess. These KegMenters previously, when we used to make them, we only made them in the 50 litre size. However, we found that was a bit of a funny size, I guess, because the 50 litres, people using that size were often making, trying to make a 50 litre batch to put into a 50 litre, standard 50 litre keg. But then, of course, the issue with that is you didn't have enough headspace. So now we've got two new sizes, and we've got a 29 litre and a 58 litre, which probably makes a bit more sense. The other thing we've changed over as well is the KegMenters now come with a standard flat cap like this, which just has a little silicon bung here and an airlock. And another small change is just underneath the flat cap, we now use the Epdm seals. We find them to be definitely much better than the silicon seals we used to use, because the silicon sometimes is just a little bit too soft. And under pressure, you would find sometimes it would roll out of place and it'd be hard to get the KegMenter up to the pressure limitations on the vessel, which is about 2.5 bar. One thing we've changed. EPDM is a really great seal. It's got great chemical resistance, lasts a long time, doesn't perish easily. And by all means, it's really a better product than the silicon ones. When you first get these, you'll notice that they are fully acid bath electrolysis pacified. So they're really well made. I guess the nice thing about the keg industry is they have fairly high standards in their pressure vessel manufacturing. So by using a product which already exists and just modifying it a little bit to make it into a keg, we're able to get a really good value sort of fermenter, which is made out of stainless steel. It's really robust, made from fairly thick stainless steel. And really, they make perfect fermenting vessels. And I know a lot of customers these days are getting into fermenting under pressure. And if you're doing that, then these are really one of the perfect vessels for that as well. The other thing is a lot of people might want to use a blow-off tube rather than the airlock that comes with the unit. So you can just use the same bung and then just get a flexible bit of tube. We have our 6mm beer line, which will do the job nicely. That's the 6mm ID, 10mm OD. So as long as it's a 10mm OD line, it'll fit nicely in these bungs, and then you can stick that at the top and make an airlock. Make a blow-off tube. I guess the advantage of a blow-off tube as well, for you guys who haven't used one before, is that if you've got a very active fermentation using the little airlock here, often what will happen is all that yeast and krausen will blow out the top of the airlock and then just ooze out all over the top of the fermenter, and that's pretty messy. So I personally love using blow-off tubes, preferably, because then I can just stick this in a bucket and then the bucket can fill up with all sorts of crap which blows off, and it's no problem. Now a lot of people say, why did we go 4-inch on the opening? The 4-inch opening is the size at the top which is easy to get your hand inside for cleaning, so anybody can get their hand in there, you can clean the insides. You can also get enough access to the inside of the vessel that you can drill holes through the wall of the vessel, fit things like thermowells and stuff like that to the side of it. Or heating elements for that matter, which I'll bring up in a tick. But also, it's a small enough size that we can get to relatively high pressures. When we go larger and larger in the lid opening on any of these pressure vessels, it gets significantly harder to get to higher pressures. So what we wanted to do is make sure we're producing a KegMenter which can go up to pressures which you can use for pushing the beer directly out of here through a filter, for instance, or you can just dispense directly from this vessel in your fridge to tap in your kegerator. Both of these sizes will fit inside your kegerators. Being able to carbonate in the vessel or naturally carbonate is also another big benefit. But for that type of stuff, you'll generally need a different lid. So we sell a different lid, which is our ball lock post lid separately. So that's this one here. So the ball lock post lid comes with three separate components. We've got a float here, and we've got a silicon flexible dip tube, and also the lid itself. Now the reason why we've set it up like this, we used to use actually a fixed stainless steel dip tube. So that was one of the fixed stainless steel dip tubes. And you can still change over to one of the fixed stainless steel dip tubes. If you get a Cornelius keg dip tube and actually chop it to the right size, you can actually take off the post and have a solid fixed dip tube. But the issue with a solid fixed dip tube we found previously was because people are often fermenting and then dispensing from this same vessel, the dip tube would often be drawing from the incorrect height. So either it would be too low, and then it would be stuck inside the yeast cake at the bottom and then draw yeast up out of the bottom of the KegMenter. Or if they chopped the dip tube too short, then it would draw too high and then you wouldn't be able to draw everything out of the keg, which is pretty annoying. So now all these new units that we sell have the floating dip tube, and they're pretty easy to set up. The dip tubes will come 60 centimeters as standard when you first buy them. So it's longer than what you need for both of these KegMenter sizes. So you'll have to chop it down a little bit. So you just fit one end to the liquid post dip tube on the underside of the lid. And then the other end, you just fit that to the actual float itself. So the silicon, you might find it slightly tricky to get on there, but if you actually wet the bottom of the 8mm tubing here, you'll be able to slip it on a lot easier. So what I normally do is have a little bit of sanitizer and actually spray the sanitizer on here, and then the silicon slips over real easy. But anyway, so this cap, which is sold separately, will enable you to essentially use this vessel as not just a fermenter, but you can also use it as a keg. You can carbonate in it, you can dispense directly from it. And really, I think most people who are using these as fermenters, probably I'd recommend graduating onto this type of lid, because it gives the whole vessel a lot more utility. Another thing we've done as well on the lids is, just for safety, we now have engraved on the top, always depressurize before removing the lid. And that's because we haven't had any incidences, touch wood, but definitely with these tri-clover type lids, it's important to remember that if this vessel is under pressure, I know some customers, what they can do is they can just flick this arm off the side, and if this blows open, then you can have this lid pop up and hit you in the face. And that's one of the main reasons why we rate these vessels to 2.5 bar. Actually, the kegs themselves can go up to significantly more pressure than that. But because we use a 4-inch triclover on top, we use this 2.5 bar pressure release valve. So that's a lower pressure release valve than normally what you'd use in a lot of other keg dispensing gear. So that's why this red pressure release valve is used. And that's why I always recommend it. It will actually be compatible, this thread, with the gray pressure release valves you normally see on the Cornelius kegs, for instance, that go up to much higher pressures. But we do discourage you from using those unless you're doing something to improve the safety of this. So there are some types of triclover clamps you can have with locking mechanisms on there and stuff to prevent people opening them unless they know what they're doing. So if you can potentially go up to higher pressures if you want to, but I would just say, word of warning, if you're not going to use our 2.5 bar pressure relief valve, which is red in color, then make sure you're putting some extra safety measures in place. That's all. So that's pretty much it with regards to the pressure lid, I guess. The other thing is, we're also selling a few other attachments which goes with these, including our heating elements. And let me grab one of those and show you what I'm talking about. Yeah, so these stainless steel stick heating elements are a really popular 2,200 watt heating element if you've got the 220, 240 volt system. Or if you're in the States and using 110 volts, then you'll have these rated to about 1,600 watts. Now, when you use these elements, they fit into both these size KegMenters. I should also say these KegMenters are both the same diameter, and they both are stackable as well. So when you got that, you can see the interlocking stackable chimes, which is kind of nice. With regards to the element, because these are both the same diameter, the element fits both of them. They're pretty easy to fit. What you need to do is drill a 32mm hole in the side of the vessel. So yeah, you'd normally go as low as you can on the cylindrical part of the vessel wall here. And then you just feed the element lead inside, pull it out through the hole in the side of the vessel, and then just do the stainless steel nut up from the outside. So that'll enable you to turn this KegMenter into a boiler, for instance, or you might use it for distillation, which I'll show you in a tick, or you might even use it for inoculation, making an inoculation vessel for sour beers. So I know that's something that has become very popular with our staff and a few other guys on the forums and stuff like that have made really great inoculation vessels out of these KegMenters. So that's perfect for sour beers, because often with sour beers, you've got to make sure that you've got no other foreign bacteria in there. And one of the safest ways to do that is actually boil in the fermenter itself. So if you have an element fitted here and you're boiling your wort in here, or whatever the mix is which you're adding your bacteria to, you can have the lid and heat the entire vessel up to 100 degrees Celsius, or boiling point essentially. And then you can be pretty confident that when you do pitch anything in there, whether that be yeast or whether it be yeast and bacteria mixed together, then you know you can be pretty confident that you know you're not going to have any other foreign microorganisms in there. So that's pretty much the element fitting. And the other thing is, when you fit the element, you can also turn the KegMenter into a still. So we have another attachment here, which is the 4-inch to 2-inch. Concentric reducer. So that just fits onto the top of the KegMenter like that, with your 4-inch triclover clamp. So that just goes on there like so. And then what you can do is that gives you a 2-inch opening at the top. Oops. There we go. So if you just get your 2-inch triclover clamp, you can actually attach one of our Alco engine reflux or pot stills. So you can directly heat, if you're using this for distillation. I know some people directly heat with a naked flame, like a gas burner or something like that. Obviously it comes with some risk if you're going to be boiling and heating up a flammable vapor with a naked flame. There's inherent risks which come with that, so I wouldn't recommend it. If you're going to be using this for distillation, I'd highly recommend using the stick element. But definitely this makes a really nice boiler, either a 58 litre boiler or 29 litre boiler for distillation. So it's a boiler which you can have a large enough opening that you can get your hand in, clean it out. See, a lot of people are doing like they're fermenting things like fruits and stuff like that, which often can have a lot of sediment and built up stuff. And you know, some people, although they've been using kegs as boilers, they have a very small opening to get inside and clean them out. So these KegMenters, because of the large opening, they're perfect for this application. So they make a really good heavy duty, you know, boilers for that application as well. Anyway, that's pretty much it. I'll probably do another video at some later stage when we get our new spunding valves out, but we have some spunding valves which fit to these ball lock posts. So I'll explain them in another video on how to use those and give you a bit more information about fermenting under pressure. Look, I know some people have been using this red 2.5 bar pressure release valve kind of as a spunding valve and just letting it blow off. Obviously, it doesn't give you much control because it's just a 2.5 bar pressure release valve. And depending on what temperature you're fermenting at, that may or may not end up with the right level of carbonation. So yeah, it's not really a very well controlled method of fermenting under pressure. So you really want to get a spunding valve if you're going to be doing that. Anyway, that's pretty much it. If you've got any other questions, just flick us an email, beer@kegland.com.au, then we can shoot you off an answer. Otherwise, join our Facebook group. There's a lot of activity there. A lot of people putting up posts and asking questions, and that's a really quick way to get a good response, either from ourselves or some of the other members on the group. Yes, that's the kegland.com.au Facebook group. Or please subscribe to our YouTube channel if you have time. All right, thanks for that, guys, and see you next time. Bye.